Good morning, Mount Comfort Church family. Welcome to another wonderful day to start our day off here and worship together. It is a very interesting time that we're in here, and I think that what centers us is to give each of us a little bit of a task. And so I've got something to set in front of you this morning for a little, maybe a little homework. The good teacher in me will pull out a little time here and give you a little task as we move forward throughout the day. I appreciate, first off, that you guys are choosing to worship with us this morning. It takes a little bit of effort to get up and to get going in these days, and so looking forward to the Sunday is something that's easy to do to break the routine, because it's not a break in the routine. Every first day of the week coming together is a blessing indeed. So here's to the task. I know this isolation process has been kind of strange, or the self-distancing, and the idea that we in society have really been harping on how we're just not connected, and boy, things have just come to a halt, and I really feel isolation more than ever. And what I've come to find out is kind of interesting is that we're not as isolated as we may think that we were before. We're very connected as a community, very connected as a city, as a state, as a country, and as a world as we see. And that connection means that maybe we weren't as isolated, but maybe something else was getting in the way, making us feel isolated from one another. And I think that might be a little bit of what we call our routines. We may have let some of our routines get into the way, and here's where we get into our task. I would like you to kind of think about your routines, because you have the time right now, I believe. Think about some of those good routines that you want to keep, and make a list of the top five. And then maybe take a look at some of the routines you want to change, or maybe alter a little bit, and make a list of those in the top five. But I want you to keep this in mind when you make those routine changes or those routine keepers. Are the things we keep in glorifying our God day in and day out? I want to challenge you to wrap your routines in those things that glorify God as we begin our service this morning. Let's bow as we go to our God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for your Son, grateful for your plan, grateful for your awesome power that you give us and let us see each and every day. Thank you so much for your word that encourages us and guides us through times that are sometimes certain and sometimes uncertain. We thank you so much for our leaders that we can rely upon, our leaders that we can look towards, the leaders that you've given us in your word that we can rely upon with certainty that they chose you and that you alone are going to be the thing that lasts through all of this. We pray that you continue to be with our families as we're in our communities and our daily life, and you be with the families in the homes, that they can work things out and make things smooth as we're in this time of uncertainty, and that we look forward so much to where we can bring our saints together as we look towards, again, the eternal salvation that you've given us. We thank you so much for that plan, because that plan alone guides us through this process. We ask for forgiveness when we put our routines or other priorities above your will and around your will, and that is not in line in accordance to what you want us to do. Pray that you help us examine ourselves, examine our walk, and to bring it closer to you again. Give us strength to do that, and help us again to look forward to the time we meet again. It's through these things we offer in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Sing on, ye joyful pilgrims,
you. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend.
This time this morning to go to the Lord in prayer, grateful for the opportunity to be in front of you and to share in this time that we are facing. There's so many things that we're hearing that is confusing, so many different ideas about what's happening, what's going on. As we think about that today and as we pray about that today, I want you to think about one thing, and that is Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In everything we're facing, the most important thing is trusting in God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for your love, your blessings. We thank you for this opportunity we have to come before you. You're an awesome God. Regardless of what the world around us is facing and what is going on, we know that you're still in charge. Regardless of what's being said, Father, we know that your hand is upon us and with us. Father, we pray that you would help us to realize more and more that regardless of the circumstance, you're still there for us. Help us to put our trust in you. Father, there are those that are hurting and need in our congregation, and brothers and sisters that have lost loved ones, and many that are sick and dealing with various illnesses and diseases. And we pray, Father, for a touch for their hearts, their lives, and a blessing upon them, Father. Father, we know that the world right now would like to have relief from what's going on. I don't know if that's your will, Father. So we pray that your will be done. Father, I don't know that there's going to be a soon stop to the virus and all that's taking place, but I pray that your will be done. I ask you, God, to guide us and to bless us as we move forward. Direct us as we continue to lead, not only by these videos that's going out, Father, but help us to lead in our homes. Help us to lead in our communities by example, by reaching out to those who are in need. And Father, most of all, we pray that you would bless our efforts and remind us and help us to know that you're still our God. We thank you for that, and we ask your blessings upon each one today. In Christ's name, amen.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is
had it not been the Lord who was on our side,
had it not been the Lord who was on our side, the anger of the enemy would have swallowed us alive, had it not been the Lord who was on our side. Blessed be the Lord who would not give us up. Blessed be the Lord for his unfailing love. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our young is in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the Lord. Had it not been the Lord who was on our side, had it not been the Lord who was on our side, the water would have engulfed us, we would naturally die. Had it not been the Lord who was on our side, blessed be the Lord who would not give us up. Blessed be the Lord for his unfailing love. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our hope is in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the Lord.
There is a method of study when you're studying the Bible. It's called the law of first mention. What does that have to do with communion? Well, when we look at when the Lord's Supper, what we call communion, was instituted, it was instituted on the night of Passover. If we want to get a good idea about Passover, we go to where it was first mentioned. You go to that first place because that gives the most succinct and simple definition of what was going on. Lots of years before Jesus sat in a room with his disciples, there was a night that happened in Egypt like none other. And it defined, and it was a picture of what Jesus would do later on. It's very, very important to go back and look at that. When Jesus gave the instituted the new covenant of his blood and his body, it was a remembrance of what the first time that happened was back in Egypt on that night when a lot of firstborn people died, firstborn people and animals. It was a horrible night. That death angel was not going to discriminate. He was going to kill Egyptians, firstborn of Egyptians, slaves, Israelites. It didn't matter. But God in his mercy gave the Israelites a way to be saved. He instituted, he said, I want you to take a lamb, 14th day of the month, and I want you to kill him. And I want you to take the blood of this lamb and paint it with a brush that like a weed, and paint it on the doorpost, the sides and the top. And you go inside, and when the death angel comes along, it's going to come along and he's going to look and see who has the blood on the doorpost. And when he does come and he sees this blood, he will pass over. You're going to be inside at the same time, and you're going to be eating lamb, the body of this lamb. And you're supposed to roast it and prepare it in the way that God said. They did that, and they were passed over. And the next day, they left Egypt. They didn't just leave, they were driven out. The Egyptians and Pharaoh had had enough. Egypt at the time looked like Hiroshima. It's not like the Prince of Egypt. It was destroyed completely and totally. Several thousand, I forget how many thousand years later, 1,300 years or so later, Jesus is in a room. It's a dark night. He knows what's going to happen. He institutes what we call the Lord's Supper. What's the connection? The connection is the blood and the body. Two things happen back in Egypt. The blood was put on the doorpost. What did the blood do? It saved their life. Life was given because blood was given. And when that blood was given and they applied it to the doorpost, it saved their firstborn's lives. It saved their lives. They were inside and they were eating. They were eating the lamb. And they were also supposed to make unleavened bread. Because when they left, they had to take this unleavened bread with them. Two things in this story, the blood and the lamb. The blood was on the outside. It was on the outside of the house, on the outside of their dwelling. That saved their lives. Inside, they were eating the lamb. The lamb went on the inside. All my life, I've taken communion, and I've heard the blood talked about a lot. We are saved by the blood. Say what Jesus did for us. The first time that really happened was back in the time of the Exodus. But the body is not talked about so much. Why? What's the deal with the body? The blood saved us, but the body was taken. It was taken internally. It was taken internally to give them the strength to leave Egypt. It gave them the strength to leave slavery to go to freedom. And then later on, when they started getting hungry again, they had the matzah, which was still part of that meal. That continued on, and that got them to freedom. They got to the other side of the Red Sea, and then the manna took over. God did that. And so when Jesus, he institutes this, he says, this is my body. When we take the bread, Jesus is the lamb. He gave the blood. He gave his body. He saved us from sin. He saved us from death. But he also made us free. If you're dead, freedom doesn't matter. If you're alive, freedom makes life worth living. So what we're going to partake here, the first thing we're going to partake is the bread. And when we take this, that's what we need to remember, what Jesus did for us with his body. He didn't just give his blood, he gave his body. And we don't want to shortchange that. So let's remember that as we take this. Holy Father, we are truly blessed by you. You are truly gracious and kind to us, Father. Thank you for the story and the events that happened in Egypt, that Jesus became the fulfillment of what we saw back then. We ask you to bless this food, Father, this bread. We thank you for it, and we thank you for what Jesus did for us. We ask this in your Son's name. Amen. Let's pray. Holy Father, you have blessed us greatly. You gave us your Son. He shed his blood for us, Father. Thank you for the life that you've given us through him. Thank you for saving us and redeeming us. Father, we love you. Help us to keep these things in mind as we take the fruit of the vine. We ask this in your Son's name. Amen. We come to a time when we're together, even when we're not so together, but we have the opportunity to return back to God part of what he's given to us. On your screen, you'll see information on different ways that you can give back. When we give, we have to be very careful so that it's not just like, okay, we did our got our points or whatever. And I think most people here are way past that. But sometimes I think we miss maybe a greater point of giving, and that is we are created in the image of God. And God is a God that gives. He gives freely. The money and things that we give to him are not so important as our heart. How we give, if we give cheerfully, we are imitating our Father. We're imitating Jesus. When we give, let's remember that. Holy Father, we are again truly blessed by you. Father, at this time, when we give back to you, help us to do it with a cheerful heart. May we be cheerful because of how you give to us. Help us to imitate Jesus. Help us to imitate you, Father, in having a giving heart. We love you, and we ask these things in your Son's name. Amen.
If the skies above you are gray, you are being so blue. If your cares and burdens seem gray,
thank you.
Come we that love the Lord and let our joys be known.
Join in our song with sweet accord.
Join in our song with sweet accord.
Church, we're glad you've come back and are with us again this Sunday. I've got good news, bad news that I missed a couple of them, but I have some birthdays. On the 15th of this month, Dennis Wirtz turned 81. On the 22nd, Jim Rand turned 86. This coming Wednesday, Libby Lanningham turns 82. And on the 1st of next month, Jim and Marge Moran are celebrating, and everybody do a drum roll at home, their 67th wedding anniversary. Congratulations to everybody on the birthdays and the anniversary. Those are some impressive numbers, every one of them. I know some of you have heard that, and probably have been talking about it, about the governor's announcing the beginning of the slow rollout. I will tell you that the elders have been praying about it, and also are doing some research to try and meet the governor's expectations when we're allowed to get back together. We hope perhaps as early as next Sunday, but we hope soon that we'll have some information on that we'll be able to start sharing with everybody as that you start to consider. I know some people may consider staying out for longer. We intend, when we start meeting again, we intend to continue. At that point, it'll be live streaming because, of course, we're taping it now. But we continue to plan to continue broadcasting the services on our YouTube channels. So we want to make that option open for everybody, especially when there's some people who are going to feel like they need to wait a little longer before they get back out into public. But I just want you to know that the elders are talking about it, praying about it, looking into trying to, as we all wait to hear what the parameters exactly what they are. We will let you know as quick as we can. You've got a Bible. I need you to turn to Joshua, the 10th chapter. And we're going to start reading there in just a minute. But if you don't know this story, and you may be familiar with it, but I want to give you the background to this when we get into chapter 10. As the book of Joshua starts, of course, God has instructed him to lead the children over the Jordan River into the promised land. And if you'll remember, the first city that they come to is Jericho. And, of course, they marched around the city for 7 days, and God caused the walls of Jericho to fall down. God instructed them to destroy everything in the city of Jericho and to take nothing away. Unfortunately, Achan, one of the fighters, took some articles from Jericho, hid them under his tent. And so when the children of Israel then turned to a little town called Ai, they were routed pretty badly. And they came back to the Lord inquiring as to what had happened. And God has instructed them to have all of the families proceed to march by before his presence came to Achan's family. And, of course, they were destroyed because of his sin. And then we actually come to a really important city. The Israelites are now in a town called Gilgal, is the area, the area that they are in. And really close to them was a very important city called Gibeon. And the Gibeonites had heard about what happened to Jericho, heard about what happened to Ai, and determined that they weren't going to let it happen to them.
And so what they did is they grabbed some of the old beat-up sandals that nobody was wearing anymore, and they got some of the old wineskins nobody was using anymore, and they got some old moldy bread. I guess maybe they let it mold. They got some old moldy bread, and they put this stuff in their packs, and the group representatives pretended to come to the Israelites, claiming to be travelers from a far, far distance, way out of their territory, where they wouldn't be interested in fighting them, but inquiring if they could make a treaty with them because of God and the power that he has displayed. There's an interesting line in chapter 9 where the Israelites sampled the provisions to make sure it's really moldy bread and it's really old wine, but the next line is important because it says, but they did not inquire of the Lord, who obviously could have said, well, guess what? This is really the people from Gibeon, their next door neighbors, you know, that you're also supposed to be destroying. So the Israelites make a treaty with them and swear an oath that they will not harm them at all. So now you got to stay with me here, okay, because this gets convoluted, all right? God had intended, the Gibeonites are right, in verse 24 and 25 of chapter 9, they tell Joshua, your servants, that's them, were clearly told how the Lord your God has commanded his servant Moses to give you the whole land to wipe out all its inhabitants from before you. That was the plan that God ordered for his people to do, not to drive people out, but to wipe out the inhabitants of the land. They made a treaty with Gibeon. Well, when they find out that Gibeon's actually a town that is close to them, Joshua prevents the people from killing them, which is what now they want to do. But see, they wanted to go back on their word to do it. God doesn't punish them for not inquiring of him, but God honors the fact that they honor their oath, and he allows them to live. Now that's where we are starting in chapter 10. So let's pick it up now, chapter 10, verse 1. Now Adonai Zedek, king of Jerusalem, heard that Joshua had taken Ai and totally destroyed it, doing to Ai and its king as he had done to Jericho and its king, and that the people of Gibeon had made a treaty of peace with Israel and had become their allies. He and his people were very much alarmed at this because Gibeon was an important city. Like one of the royal cities, it was larger than Ai, and all its men were good fighters. So Adonai Zedek, king of Jerusalem, appealed to Hoam, king of Hebron, Piram, king of Jarmuth, Japhia, king of Lachish, and Debir, king of Eglon. Come up and help me attack Gibeon, he said, because it has made peace with Joshua and the Israelites. Then the five kings of the Amorites, the kings of Jerusalem, Hebron, Jarmuth, Lachish, and Eglon, joined forces. They moved up with all their troops and took up positions against Gibeon and attacked it. The Gibeonites then sent word to Joshua in the camp at Gilgal, do not abandon your servants. Come up to us quickly and save us, help us, because all the Amorite kings from the hill country have joined forces against us. So Joshua marched up from Gilgal with his entire army, including all the best fighting men. The Lord said to Joshua, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid of them. I have given them into your hand, and not one of them will be able to withstand you. After an all-night march from Gilgal, Joshua took them by surprise. The Lord threw them into confusion before Israel, so Joshua and the Israelites defeated them completely at Gibeon. Israel pursued them along the road between going up to Beth-horon and cut them down all the way to Azekah and Makkedah. As they fled before Israel on the road down from Beth-horon to Azekah, the Lord hurled large hailstones down on them, and more of them died from the hail than were killed by the swords of the Israelites. On the day the Lord gave the Amorites over to Israel, Joshua said to the Lord in the presence of Israel, sun, stand still over Gibeon, and you, moon, over the valley of Ajalon. So the sun stood still, and the moon stopped till the nation avenged itself on its enemies, as it is written in the book of Jasher. The sun stopped in the middle of the sky and delayed going down about a full day. There has never been a day like it before or since, a day when the Lord listened to a human being. Surely the Lord was fighting for Israel. Then Joshua returned with all the Israel to the camp at Gilgal. Now, I said this story, in trying to explain this story, it sounds a little convoluted. couple of things I really wanted to try and key in on before we really actually get to the battle itself. The first thing here is God's order to the Israelites was to go into the land and wipe out all of the current residents in the land, that it might be for God's people and God's people alone, the promised land. Now, what this has led to is a lot of people who question whether the God of the Old Testament is the same God as the God of the New Testament. Question whether or not that God was a vindictive, angry God, whereas the God of New Testament is a loving God, and that they don't seem to have anything in common with each other, and so therefore it must be a different God. I need you to hear this. God's never changed. Scripture is clear on the fact that God is unchanging. God is God. And the same God that is described in 1 Corinthians 13 in all the measure of his love for us, desired to have that love for his nation Israel, desired for them to love him back, that God was the same God. But it's important for us to understand, and I use the word convoluted on purpose. Sometimes the plans of God seem convoluted to us. They seem to have no rhyme or reason in the bigger scheme of things, or they seem to be vindictive. You know, I mean, boy, he's brought fire down on cities. He has wiped out entire fighting armies. We may not grasp that. Church, we're not asked to grasp why God does what he does. We are asked to accept in faith that it's God who did it, and God knows why. In the time that we are living in, that becomes awfully important. There's stuff flying around about who's going to fix this and about who's going to come up with that and all of the different medications that they're trying and all that the talk about a year, I guess, or 14 months from now, they figure they'll have a vaccine for it. And, you know, I don't know if that's the case, or I don't know when it's going to happen. I don't know why 40,000 people have died by this, but I know that God knows. And we're supposed to trust him because he knows. And I want to challenge you in thinking about that, because sometimes people kind of get their hackles up about that one and say, well, that's not the God I want to follow. When I was 4 and 5 years old, my parents could have told me I was going to the moon. I was going because they were going with me. Because that's the kind of faith I had in them when I was little. They could do no wrong. I know some of you didn't grow up in that kind of a home. And sometimes you struggle more than the rest of us because we were blessed with Christian parents. We were blessed with that kind of example to be able to understand, to relate to this idea of trusting God. But God knows what's going on here. And God has an intent for it. And here's the interesting thing. I told you that God said that they were supposed to wipe out the inhabitants of the land. Now remember, go to the huge fortified city Jericho. Now Ai's not really talked about, but Ai was also a fortified town, because by the way, everyone was. It's just Ai wasn't as big as Jericho. And you know, and the five armies that were talked about here, the Amorites, are all fortified cities. And isn't it amazing that while God doesn't punish the Israelites because they don't inquire of him, and God does honor them for keeping their word and not hurting the Gibeonites, what it does is it sets the stage because of the panic of the king of Jerusalem to come out of his fortified city to attack Gibeon, that the Israelites are able to attack him in the open and to defeat them. Oh, how often it's not apparent to us why God does what he does. But boy, God sure knows what he's doing. It's interesting here that Adonizedek, what he says to the other kings is, they've made a treaty with Israel and they're going to be their allies. That was true and it wasn't true. They did make a treaty with Israel so they could live. They did not become their allies. They actually became their servants. And actually, you probably ought to more correctly put the word slaves there. They actually became, they pledged themselves to be slaves for Israel in return for their lives. But because, again, Adonizedek makes the leap that he now has to fight the Israelites and the Gibeonites, he decides that what he needs to do is to trim down the danger. And so they come out of their fortified cities, and of course, and they attack Gibeon. And of course, the Gibeons, if Gibeonites, if we're in verse 6 here, send the word, don't abandon your servants, come up and quick and save us. I've been kind of thinking about this one all day, because the United States makes a lot of treaties. And sometimes there are treaties that we've done really a very honorable job of honoring and keeping, and there are sometimes, in truth, as a country, we haven't. And I would definitely say about the Native Americans in this country, we made treaty after treaty after treaty after treaty that we just broke. We just didn't keep our word, and we just ran it over anyway. It's interesting because there really wasn't anything in this for the Israelites. The Gibeonites said, oh, we want to make a treaty with you because you're such a big deal, see, because you're so important. Because, you know, and so we want to be on your side. And I think they were too busy getting puffed up about their self-importance than they were to think about inquiring to God as to whether or not these were they were telling the truth to start with. World is full of countries who over the centuries have made treaties and broken them. Made treaties and broken them. I don't know if you've ever played, and boy, now I'm not going to be able to think of the game, a Risk, where you have the entire world and you put armies on it and you fight each other with the roll of the dice, and whoever's, of course, the last one that's standing, you know. Well, back when Lynn and I were on opposite shifts at Disney World, I would play Risk games with about three or four friends of mine that would go all day long because we were working the night shift. And they would go to three or four days of games. So I was coming up to my next, you know, thing where you get the three things so that you can get armies. And we were up to like 500 armies you were supposed to get. And so I'm looking around on the board, and everybody, boy, it's pretty thin. I mean, everything is pretty much evenly distributed. But there was one point where I was sitting that the other guy in Europe had one army. And so I put them all on there. And he said, you made a treaty to not attack me for four rounds. And I went, treaties are made to be broken. What can I tell you? The Israelites committed themselves, I want you to consider this, committed themselves not only to not killing Gentiles, committed themselves to saving their lives. Was it in God's plan? No. Did God honor it, allowing them to go and allowing them to be victorious because his greater plan for his people was being done? The will of God was being accomplished. Yes. So Israel, immediately he loads up the army, right? And he heads over there. And so the first, there's two phrases going to be on the screen today, okay? And the first one actually is in verse 8, do not be afraid of them. I've given them into your hand. Do not be afraid of them. I really don't know how to put my hand on what exactly is going on in the world with this virus. But it has struck me that what this has become is the most paralyzing time in my lifetime. With literally not just people being asked to stay at home, but literally people being paralyzed with fear of the unknown. We are locked into what ifs. And I think Satan is playing them for all that he's worth. What if my job doesn't come back? What if somebody's family member gets the disease? What if my older parent or grandparent who's in the nursing home and they're locked down and nobody can talk to them gets, and it, even if it's not this disease, but starts to have the natural diseases of old age and starts to pass away and we can't be there? I mean, what ifs are running rampant. In the first chapter, before they cross over into the promised land, and he asked the people to consecrate themselves to take the task of going over the river, and it's actually, of course, through the river, but he five times he tells them to be of good courage. And about halfway through the chapter, he says, be of good courage, be courageous, and he says, and don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. And you got to understand, he doesn't say don't be afraid because some of you, because none of you are going to die. See, we think that this is an offer from God to make us bulletproof, you know, to make it where nothing can happen to us. See, we all want to be. We all like the superhero movies, and we want to. That's what we think God is offering. You know, to make us superheroes, and God and Satan can't touch it. He doesn't say bad things can't happen. What he says is, don't be afraid, for your Lord, the Lord your God, will be with you wherever you go. Guys, we talk about this a lot of weeks, and I apologize for coming back to it. If your Christianity is in a stalemate, if your Christianity is in kind of this locked spot, and maybe it is the fear of all the things that are floating around, and boy, TV doesn't help, and I don't go on the internet, but I'm guessing the internet, the open talking sites probably don't help either in a way, the way people feel about this. Maybe what you're missing is the faith that having God by your side is greater and of more importance than whatever this world's circumstances can bring. He doesn't offer to fix everything. He doesn't offer to keep you from everything. And he didn't offer with Joshua either. But he said your lack, the ability to not be afraid should come from one truth and one truth only. I'm the Lord your God and I'm with you. And I don't know what ifs are strangling you today. I don't know what ifs maybe are taking over your thought process, and it's all that you can think about. And you know, and all of us, I know I've got one. All of us have great imaginations. All of us have, you know, have the ability, you know, to have that stuff just go wild in our heads. What's supposed to dominate our thinking is this. The Spirit that dwells in us, the Son who died for us, the God who's getting ready to welcome us home in heaven one day, they are with us all the time. They'll never leave us alone, and that in itself is supposed to be enough to overcome fear. I wonder how we're doing. And then isn't it interesting, after the all-night march, as Joshua, as it's recorded, it says they took him by surprise. Kind of reminds me of later on, it'll be Gideon, you know, taking them by surprise, the Midianites by surprise. But I want you to notice just a couple of things. Verse 10 says, so they took them by surprise and the Amorites were totally thrown into confusion. Okay, anybody looking at your Bible? It says the Lord threw them into confusion before Israel. And then as they flee, the five armies, and they take off and they run, right? And they're chasing them, behind them down the road. And God brings down large hailstones, and it says kills more of them than the Israelites did with their swords. But it's the next line here, is the next one. This one, next one we're going to have on the screen. On the day the Lord gave the Amorites over to Israel. Won't you hear what it just said? It says the Lord gave them over. In other words, the reverse of that statement is, on the day the Lord gave Israel the victory. I was unsure whether I was going to say this or not, and I'm just going to say it. 2 weeks ago, the governor of New York, Governor Cuomo, said unequivocally that God will have no hand in fixing this epidemic. That'll be doctors, nurses, scientists. He says, God has no place in this. We're going to do it. And there are now commercials out that they're running that shows scientists and doctors and nurses, and they're all saying, we'll win it. You know, we're in it to win it, and we'll win it and whatnot. And they say, we'll be the answer to it. Did the Israelites do the fighting here? Absolutely. Did Joshua, just like Moses before him, probably lead them smartly in battle in the way that he deployed him and put him in battle? Absolutely. Did they rout the five armies and send them fleeing? Absolutely. Did God listen to them and make the sun stand still so that they could complete the battle? Because by the way, sunset, the battle always stopped. And so whatever you had done to that point, see, you could do. But once you were there, the other army had a chance to get away because it stopped. Nobody fought at night. I don't know if you know this or not, but nobody fought at night until the Civil War. Our Civil War in the middle of the 1800s. And Even then, they only tried it like twice or three times, and it was basically a disaster all three times. Did Israel do all those things? Yes, they did. Did they win the battle? No, they didn't. Do I believe we'll come out of this viral pandemic that we're in? Yes, I do. Do I believe that the doctors and nurses and the scientists will finally successfully come up with a vaccine that we'll start taking every year to try and protect us from this? Yes, I do. But let me ask the question, where did science come from? Where did the doctors, the nurses, and the scientists get their talent from? By the way, the verse in the Bible does not say all good gifts for Christians come from above, does it? What does it say? All good gifts come from above. Where did they get the skills to find it? From God. Where did they get the ability, the time to be able to do it? From God. Where did they get the materials? All of it was created by God's hand. And so the thing is, are they going to put in the effort? Absolutely. Will I give them every bit of credit that they deserve for the hard work and the standing up in those hospitals and everything that they're doing while this is going on? Absolutely. But the results are God's, not ours. And church, we've been talking about this issue of having a vision. And we've got to stop locking a vision into a result. The results are God's. Our vision can only be the effort that we put forth. Thanking God for the tools he gives us. Thanking God for the opportunities he gives us. Thanking God for the time that he gives us to be able to do it. And to go out and celebrate together the effort. And then thank God for the result, whatever it is. The day, that's this day. It doesn't matter that the battle went all day. It doesn't matter that it went essentially another day after this before they finally defeated them. The effort was theirs, but the tools that they had for the effort were God's. And church, if there's any place, it should be us that understand what the difference is, that understand what that means. How many churches get sucked down the road, kind of like the Israelites with the Gibeonites, of starting to feel pretty good about ourselves for all the things we're accomplishing, instead of getting on our knees? Les has been here twice a week with us doing the filming. Michael's been here some. Teresa's been here some. But Les has been here every time. Well, except for one time, and yet when you were sick at home. And I thank God that he's able to be here. But you know the truth is, the skills that he has to be able to do this filming comes from the hand of God. The time that God has allowed him to be able to make in his schedule to be able to do this comes from the hand of God. Oh, let's not fall into the same trap that the Israelites did. Let's not fall into the trap that countless over the centuries churches have fallen in the ensuing years, where we start to think it's us, where we start to think that we're the reason that there's 500 people in the room. We start to think it's us because it's such a great building. It start to think it's us. None of it's us. All of it's God Almighty. As he puts into their hands the victory, let's just praise God for whatever victory he puts into our hands. But give him credit. Why did God allow the sun to stand still? I don't know. Any more than I don't know why in the world God doesn't punish the Israelites because they didn't inquire of him. Think of how different this story would have been simply if when the Gibeonites showed up, they had said, Lord, who are they really? We're going to be in the book of Joshua for a couple, 3 weeks. There are a lot of people, matter of fact, there are a lot of my preaching contemporaries who don't preach out of the Old Testament at all. That was that angry God. Why would we need to study that? His son even hadn't come yet. I mean, what's the purpose of that for us? This is 66 books of relationships. Your relationship with your God has played out in this chapter by the children of Israel and their leader Joshua. To learn from their mistakes, to celebrate for them the victory that is God's and God's alone. to learn how to transfer the element of trust and to let the what-ifs go to the side. Guys, I don't have the answer to the what-ifs. I sit in an awful lot of hospital rooms and an awful lot of, now I can't think what the name of it is, hospices. And people have questions about what if. You know who knows the answer? God Almighty. What's your what if this morning? What's got you paralyzed in panic, in fear? God knows what the outcome is going to be. From an earthly standpoint, maybe it is going to be some people in our congregation end up diseased and die, and then be taken home to be with the Lord. Maybe it is that nobody is touched. I don't know what the outcome is going to be. But I know I've got an answer for the what if. God knows. And that's supposed to be enough. This morning, we're going to put up on the screen the elders' phone numbers. And listen, what I want you to do is this. I want you to take a chance. I said that last week. Somebody actually texted me and said, you know, talking about gambling doesn't sound like a good idea. We are putting ourselves out when we call up or we put a message to somebody that we don't know very well. And maybe you don't know any of our elders very well. They may not know you very well, but they trust the Lord, and they trust the job in God's church that God has given them to do, to be our spiritual guides, to be our spiritual touchstone between towards Jesus, and to be the ones charged with praying for us and helping us stay on the straight and narrow. Won't you take a chance this morning and give them a call? And I'll say again, and I say every week, and I know a lot of the lessons that we've been doing right now aren't really about salvation in Jesus Christ. But everything in the Old Testament leads us up to but one is for one reason. All of it is to have a people that were God's, who knew about God and knew about the coming Messiah, to prepare the way for Jesus to come and to give himself for us. Thought Roger did a great job with communion this morning. I sure hope you were blessed by it. If you need to know more information about becoming one of God's children, won't you please call one of the elders? All of our numbers, if you have a bulletin or you have your hands on one, all of our numbers are in there as well. We'd be glad to talk to you. Whatever your need is, God can provide, because not only is he here, but God knows where we're going. After we have a word of prayer, we're going to close with one more song. I don't know how many more weeks we're going to do this. We're going to continue to try and gather this way as long as need be. I sure look forward to the day where I get to look at something other than this little round eyepiece here and get to see you face to face. Let's have a word of prayer. We'll close with song. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the account that you give us here with Joshua and with the children of Israel and the battle that they fought. Thank you for the wonder of the miracle that you show of being in charge of the very laws of nature on this planet, that you were able to stop the sun, stop the moon, and I don't know whether that meant you literally stopped them or you stopped the rotation of the earth. It's totally irrelevant. What's relevant is your power was on display, and we thank you so much for that. One more opportunity for us to be emboldened in our faith. One more opportunity for us to be empowered to trust you, to believe that you know what's best, even though the world may say it's going down a path that with no return, and other people may be talking about it being doomsday, that the outcome's not the issue. The issue is you're in charge of it. Help us to trust you. Teach us how to have faith and to be able to act and to overcome the fears that would cripple us. In all things, Father, you and you alone are everything in our life. And it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. I hope you have a great week.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. For this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let's do that again. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. For this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.